Here it is, men. The mail call, bringing you a letter from home. This is for you. A personal letter from Bob Burns, Dinah Shore, George Montgomery, Johnny Mercer, and Meredith Wilson, addressed to every soldier, sailor, and marine of the United Nations. It's postmarked Hollywood, and it's addressed to you.
Hi there, men. This is Bob Burns. I hope you don't mind if I just talk this letter to you. My handwriting's so bad, folks usually think I write them in a post office pen over plowed ground in the rumble seat of a Jeep. Well, so I guess you can see I better just stick to talking. Got a lot of good people here to help out. There's that eye-warming sight, Dinah Shore, over there. She's going to sing a paragraph or two. George Montgomery, he's going to team up with Dinah in a little comedy drama. Johnny Mercer, young fella who wrote, My Mama Done Told Me, you know, My Mama Done Told Me. Well, that's anyhow, he's going to sing, too. You know, I can't understand that. Johnny Mercer sings like I play the bazooka, but folks seem to like it. Well, Meredith Wilson's fidgeting around over there in front of the orchestra. I guess he wants to get started with the music making. Every week we give a musical salute to a different branch of the service. But this, well, this is sort of extra special. Because you're going to hear the new words that Leo Robbins had just put into the Marine hymn. So let's go, Meredith.
In the South Pacific jungle, or the North Atlantic fog, they're the same old rough, tough leathernecks. They're the same old devil dog. Every dog boy in the army who has known what fighting means will salute the strength and valor of the United States Marines. Yes, they fight their country's battles on the land as on the sea. And today they fly from earth to sky to engage the enemy. Let the stand on land be hand to hand for a clash of war machines. But the foe they meet will never beat the United States Marines.
Hear all those fellas clapping and cheering out there in the audience? Well, there's every kind of a uniform out there. Army, Navy, Marines, RAF, fighting men from all over the United Nations. They're here on leave. And I'll bet every one of those fellas is just holding his breath for Dinah Shore to get up here and sing. Well, you won't have to hold it much longer because here she is. What you gonna do, Dinah?
Well, Bob, for my part of this letter to the boys, I'd like to sing a number written by Johnny Mercer and Jerome Kern. Dearly beloved.
Well, put it right in the envelope, Dinah. We're all listening.
Tell me that it's true. Tell me you agree. For you, you were meant for me. Dearly beloved, how clearly I see somewhere in heaven you were fashioned for me. Save me, fate gave me a sign. I know that I'll be yours.
Well, it sounds to me like they got a hankering for more, Dinah, and I can't say I blame them.
Well, if they really want another number, I think I have an idea. There's nothing like singing a song along with the guy who wrote it. And we have the composer of Blues in the Night right here on the show. How about it, Johnny? Let's go.
All right. My mama done told me when I was in knee pants. My mama done told me,
son, a woman will sweet talk and give you the glad eye. But when that sweet talking's done, a woman's a two-faced, a worrisome thing who'll leave you to sing the blues in the night.
Now the rains are falling,
hear the trains are calling, whee.
My mama done told me, hear that lonesome whistle
blowing across the trestle, whee.
My mama done told me,
ahooey, dahooey, old clickety-clacks are echoing back the blues in the night. La ha ha, la ha ha.
From Natchez to Mobile, Memphis to St. Joe,
wherever the four winds blow, I've been in some big town
and I heard me some big talk.
But there is one thing I know,
a woman's a two-faced, a worrisome thing who'll leave you to sing
the blues in the night.
Well, that sure was in the groove, or as we say in Arkansas, that was definitely in the furrow. And, Dinah, I want to tell you, anytime you get tired of Hollywood, I think I can always get you a steady job as prima donna in the gold room of the farmer's market. Yes, sir, but now that's pretty much it. I'll tell you something, boys. I almost missed this. You know, a lot of you boys wrote me and asked me to tell you the news of Van Buren. Well, I didn't want you to miss anything, so I wrote Grandma, and she sent me all the news. I just got the letter today. So I'm going to read you, boys. I can pretty near smell liver on this paper. You know, well, anyhow, here's what Grandma said. Grandma says, "Dear Robin, you asked me to give you the latest news about your kinfolks. Well, I called them up to come to my house. Yesterday, I heard a noise, and when I looked out the front window, here come your folks down the road in a wagon, all 47 of them. I'm telling you, Robin, they look just like the B Company of the Grapes of Wrath coming down Tobacco Road." Of course, the younger ones wanted to dance, so they piled up the furniture and rolled back your Uncle Slug. I declare, that's my drinking uncle. I declare, I don't know what your Uncle Slug has been drinking, but I noticed the bottle had a fuse in it. I declare, I don't know what I'm going to do with that boy. She calls him a boy. He's 47 years old. He has always been a drinker, but here lately he has started taking drinks between drinks. I got him a job as a glass blower in the glass factory here where they make them 5-gallon water bottles for the Army, but he got fired. The very first day, he got the heat cup and blowed 200 percolator tops before they could stop him. He He says, I told you in my last letter that your cousin Lobelia got married. Lobelia looks just fine, but I declare I think the girl needs glasses. She just got back from her honeymoon, and I'm pretty sure that ain't the same fella she left with. She said, Robin, we are all so proud of your Uncle Larson. That's my Uncle Petty Larson. That's my stealing. That's his name. That's my stealing uncle. She said, you remember he used to steal anything he could get his hands on, but since war broke out, he has reformed. Now he only steals things beginning with A, like A horse, A cow, A pig. You asked me about your Grandpa Snazzy. Well, me and Grandpa ain't speaking. Now she says that, you know, Robin, I can't imagine what's the matter. She says, you know, Robin, I have always been a good wife, but this time he has gone too far. For the last 46 years, I have scrubbed your Grandpa's back every Saturday night. Well, last Saturday night, he come home and his back had already been scrubbed. She said, well, I close now. Let us hear from you more often, even if it's only $5 or $10. Well, thank you, boy. Well, that pretty much winds up the communique from the Ozark. We better be getting on with the main letter here.
Bob, can I inject another syllable or so here?
Why, sure thing, Johnny. Have you met the boys?
Well, I know most of them. We've been kicking around on a little shortwave show called Song Sheet, where we sort of dish out the words to current pop tunes so the guys can copy them down. But there's one little opus the fellas really seem to be latching into, so I'd like to include it in this letter. It's the Ballad of Burlesque, the Chronicle of Queenie, the Saga of the Striptease.
Words and music by Mercer?
The old square himself. Meredith, let's vamp into strip polka. There's a burlesque theater where the gang loves to go to see Queenie, the cutie of the burlesque show. And the thrill of the evening is when out Queenie skips and the band plays the polka while she strips. Take it off, all the customers shout. Take it off, while the band beats it out. But she's always a lady, even in pantomime. So she stops and always just in time. She's as fresh and as wholesome as the flowers in May, and she hopes to retire to the farm someday. But you can't buy a farm until you're up in the chips. So the band plays the polka while she strips. Take it off, cries a voice from the rear. Take it off, soon it's all you can hear. But she's always a lady, even in pantomime. So she stops, and always just in time. Queenie, queen of them all, Queenie, someday you fall. Someday church bells will chime in strip polka time. Oh, she hates corny waltzes and she hates the gavotte. And there's one big advantage if the music's hot. It's a fast-moving exit just in case something rips. So the band plays the polka while she strips. Drop around, take it in. It's the best in the West. Take it off, you can yell like the rest. Take her out when it's over. She's a peach when she's dressed, but she stops and always just in time. Queenie, queen of them all, Queenie, someday you fall. Someday church bells will chime in the strip polka time.
Well, we usually put in a paragraph or two of play acting in this letter. This time it's an original story we whipped up especially just for this program. It's called It Shouldn't Happen to a Marine. That young fella from out 20th Century Fox way, George Montgomery, is a Marine, and Dinah Shore is what to a Marine shouldn't happen, if you get what I mean. And here they are, George and Dinah. Now, This here story starts out in Washington, D.C. You know, these days, Washington is filled to the brim with men and women who are doing a mighty fine job. Every available living place is needed for them. Naturally, if you're on official business and reserve a room in advance, you'll have a place to sleep. But only a Marine like Nick Taylor could walk into town and get a choice room right off the bat. Well, it was all like this.
Desk clerk speaking. Now, the OWI and FCC are meeting in 903 with the OPA and WPB. You might try the FHA or ICC or AFR or the... Thank you. Now, what can I do for you, sir?
I'd like a ROOM and BATH.
Ha, ha, ha. What's the name?
Sergeant Nick Taylor, Marine Corps.
No kidding. I got a brother in the Marines. He's flying in the Pacific.
So was I, but my eyes went bad and they transferred me back here to Washington.
Well, as far as I'm concerned, Bud, anything I can do for you, I'm doing for my brother. You're going to get the best room in this hotel.
Thanks.
You can have it in 3 weeks.
3 weeks? Look, Bud, I'm not choosy. I'm sleepy. I'll take anything. I'm willing to pay $3 for it.
Listen, for $3 a night in this place, you loosen your collar and hang yourself up on the hat rack.
Well, I'm not spending another night in that telephone booth.
Clerk, I'm checking out. Will you get my bill, please?
Why, certainly, Miss Williams. Can I have your key?
What? I just put it here on the desk.
Huh?
It's gone.
I don't suppose you could have seen it, Sergeant.
Key?
Yeah.
Me? No.
No.
I didn't see any key. I have bad eyes, you know. Good night.
Good night.
I can't imagine where that key went, clerk. Well, anyway, I was sharing the room with Diane Parker. I left a note telling her I was called away suddenly, but she'll keep the room, and I'm sure she won't have any trouble getting a new roommate.
My room. Won't you come in a moment, Harvey?
No, thanks, Diane. It's rather late. And my future wife's conduct must be beyond reproach.
Oh, it's all right. Come on in. I want you to meet my roommate. Now, sit down. She's probably in the bedroom. I'll see if she's still awake. Oh!
What was that?
Oh, nothing. Nothing.
Nothing?
Gladys has a little trouble with her adenoid.
Well, it sounded like a man.
Oh, she dreams about men.
And does she whistle for them, too? If you don't mind, I think I'll go in and have a look at Gladys.
Not in her nightie. Harvey, you better stay out of here.
And why should I?
Harvey, maybe you're right. You better go home. It wouldn't look right having a man in here. Gladys is so prudish, a regular old maid, you know.
I suppose that's why she wears that long woolen underwear.
What? Oh, yeah, poor darling. Her blood's thin. She looks so funny in it, too.
Not half so funny as she must look in those size 11 shoes.
Her shoes? Oh, well, her feet aren't her fault. Her mother was frightened by a rowboat. Besides, she walks a lot. Doctor's orders. She has bad lungs.
Mm. Yes, I don't wonder, smoking that cigar.
Harvey, why don't you go home and get some sleep? Your eyes are practically closed.
On the contrary, my eyes are just beginning to open.
Excuse me.
Oh!
If you folks will toss me my woolies, I'll go back to my phone booth where I can get some sleep.
Well...
Take it easy, buddy. If you raise your eyebrows any higher, you'll scalp yourself.
Diane, I think you should tell Gladys that she's badly in need of a shave. Good night.
Wait, Harvey. I can explain this. It's very simple.
Well, your explanation may be simple, but I'm not. Good night.
This is my, brother.
Your what?
My brother, Jim. Aren't you?
Yes, ma'am. I mean, sure. Sis?
How's everything at home, Jim?
Swell, just wonderful.
How's Papa?
He died.
Oh, that's terrible. When?
1915.
Now, how's about a big kiss for your baby brother?
Huh?
Come here.
But, oh, I guess brother isn't such a baby anymore.
Just like old times. Here, give little brother another kiss.
But wait. Oh, stop it, Jack.
I'm Jim. Jack's in the Navy. Holy smoke, I almost forgot. Jack said to give you a kiss for him. Here.
Oh.
Isn't she a lucky girl, Harvey? 16 brothers, and every one of them sent her kisses.
16? Did you say 16?
Sure. Don't you remember? Pop even had offers from Hobby Lobby. Come here.
Oh.
Diane.
Yes, Harvey, dear.
Are you aware that man's arms are still around you?
Are they? Oh, dear. What am I doing? Is this me?
That settles it. We're through. Your conduct is absolutely disgraceful.
Just a minute, mister. When you make a crack like that to my sister, smile.
Very well, I'm smiling. Why?
I just wanted to pick out a good tooth.
Well, go ahead. Pick it out.
Oh. Well, go ahead. Pick it up.
Diane, you just stood there and let him hit me. This is the finish.
Oh, what have you done to him, you meddling brute?
Gee, I didn't know you'd be sore at me.
Well, what do you expect me to be? Finding you in my room in the middle of the night and throwing out my perfectly good fiancé and... Hey, I might have married that stuffed shirt.
You mean you're not going to marry him?
Well, what's that got to do with you?
Well, you might be looking around for somebody else, and you might even look at me.
I am looking at you.
Not that I'm trying to rush you or anything, but you know how it is with Marines here today and in Japan tomorrow.
Are you going away?
Interested?
I didn't say I was.
You didn't say you weren't.
How long do you think you'll be here?
Not long. I've been assigned to work with some civilian aviation expert. But I don't want to get back in one of those desk jobs. I want to get in some action.
Do you think you can arrange it?
Sure. All I have to do is get on the good side of this guy, Witherspoon. He'll get me transferred.
Oh, I'm sure you won't. Did you say Witherspoon?
Yeah.
Oh. He's the man you're supposed to work for.
Know him?
10 minutes ago, I was engaged to him.
Yeah? Well, yeah. Honey, what? You mean that withered goon was Witherspoon?
It certainly was. And you just threw him out on his ear.
Holy smoke. Wait here. I gotta find it. Hey, where's his tooth? Oh, here. Mr. Witherspoon? Mr. Witherspoon? Mr. Witherspoon!
Thanks, Dinah Shore and George Montgomery. That sure was swell. Say, we gotta be gluing down the envelope on this letter pretty soon. But there's one more thing we want to send you first. It's a new song I think you're gonna like, especially you Navy men. Meredith Wilson is the composer, and, well, he'll tell you about it. Come in here, Meredith.
Well, Bob, it's all about the famous mythical ship of the Navy, the USS Tuscarora. It's sort of the promised land to every gob. The one ship that's really got everything.
Well, let's hear it, Meredith.
Okay, Bob. I'll sing the first verse just to show you how it goes. Then after the first time, let's all join in on the chorus. Oh, I've sailed the Flying Dutchman. I've followed Jonah's whale. I rigged a 7-master with an old shirt tail. But I will be in heaven and never go ashore the day I swing my hammock on the old Tuscarora. I'm going to ship over mates, like I told you before, a ship over mates on the old Tuscarora. So help me up the ladder, I'm a wiser man and sadder, and I won't leave the Navy anymore when I swing my hammock on the Tuscarora.
Dinah, you sing the next verse. All set?
Okay, let her ride.
Oh, the engine room is furnished with moving picture screens, and you know where to find the latest magazines. A girl in every port doesn't mean a thing no more. There's a girl in every port, hold on the old Tuscarora.
Another ship, another ship, another ship, another ship, and I'll never leave the Navy anymore.
Hey, Johnny Mercer.
Why, don't tell me you want my dyspeptic baritone in this potpourri.
Why not? I'm going to take the next one myself.
All her stacks are made of rubber because they reach so high. They've got to stretch a point to let the moon get by. Her hosen and her swabbins, the automatic kind. You press a little button and your bright work is shined. I'm going to ship over mates like I told you before, and I'll never leave the Navy anymore.
Now, if you can stand it, I'll tell you a little about the Tuscarora myself and then wind up into Ozark Overture on the bazooka for the final chorus. Look out, Meredith, here it comes. Oh, she's got a beach for swimming, the artificial sand, and 40 little mermaids who will hold your hand. Her stores are from Vassar, and navigators too. You ought to see the waiting list, the sign on the crew.
I'm gonna ship over mates like I told you before. Ship over mates on the old Tuscarora. So help me up the ladder, I'm a wiser man and better, and I won't leave the Navy anymore. When I sweep my hand upon the Tuscarora.
Well, I guess we'll never be able to top that, folks, so we better be going. But everybody here, Dinah Shore, George Montgomery, Johnny Mercer, Meredith Wilson, and me, well, we all wish you the very best of luck and good hunting. Yours truly, Bob Burns.
This is Del Sharpe reminding you that another letter from home will be coming your way the next time you hear The Mail Call. The Mail Call is produced for the men of the Armed Forces of the United Nations by the Special Service Division of the War Department of the United States of America.
In the South Pacific jungles or the North Atlantic fogs, they're the same old roughed-up leathernecks, they're the same old devil dogs. Every doughboy in the army who has known what fighting means will salute the strength and valor of the United States Marines. Yes, they fight their country's battles on the land and on the sea. And today they fly from earth to sky to engage.